On this episode of Bio, delighted to be joined by Matthew Hatton, a career spanning nearly 14 years in the professionals, held the European welterweight title, challenged for a WBC super welterweight title as well, and there's so much in between and around to talk about. Matt, it's great to see you, mate. How are you, you doing today? And you're looking forward to doing this?
I am. You mentioned it to me before, and we've been friends for a while, haven't we, mate? So, yeah, really looking forward to it. Like you say, 14-year career, a lot of fights, so plenty to talk about, would have thought.
Plenty to talk about, and it's kind of customary with these bio interviews that we do to start off right at the beginning. So, born and raised, Matt, where were you born and raised?
I was born in Stockport, Stepping Hill. We lived mainly in pubs as a kid. I'd never lived in a house till I was 14. That's what my mum and dad did. Used to run pubs. Might be why me and Ricky like a few scoops. I don't think you've got to be a brain surgeon to work that one out. But yeah, raised in pubs, and as you can imagine, some fun stories and so being around characters all the time. Being around adults and stuff like that. So, yeah, we grew up quick.
Well, when you're growing up around pubs and the pub scene, you've kind of touched on something I was going to ask you about. You must see all sorts of characters, but you do. You grow up quick, don't you? Because you're in a fast-moving environment and there's a lot of adults around.
Yeah.
So were you a bit of a man-child?
Yeah, we was, again, around adults a lot of the time and pretty good at pool and darts as well. So, yeah, when I look back on me childhood, great times, really was. My mum and dad were great parents. They always supported us in whatever we did. They always encouraged us to do sports. And from a social aspect, I mean, it sounds ridiculous now. I remember we used to have singers on in the pub, and I still love live entertainment to this day. You know, when I go out and stuff like that, I love going to see bands and stuff like that. And I think that's from being brought up in pubs. You know, we'd be sat there, me and our kid, you know, when these singers on in the pub, we used to sit with my nana and granddad actually in the corner of the pub. Great times.
You mentioned there that your parents are very supportive. So, you know, did you sort of grow up in a traditional nuclear family type of setup then?
Yeah, we had a great childhood. We really did. We didn't want for anything. We was always pushed towards sport. My mum and dad always worked hard, and we had everything that we ever needed. It wasn't with some fighters and some boxers. They come sometimes from a tough background. And even though we was brought predominantly on Hattersley, in a pub on Hattersley, which sort of like people get in their head, it was quite a rough estate. They were great times as playing out as kids and stuff like that. I look back on my childhood with fond memories. It was great.
When people sort of assess an area as being rough, or they have that perception from the outside, but you're actually living in the area and you're seeing a different side of it. Mm. What's that actually like? Because you're saying that actually, whilst some people perceived it to be a rough area, you didn't have that perception. It was fun almost. So what sort of nuances and little quirks made it such a fun place to grow up?
It was one of them places, and it still is now. You know, I still go on the onto my friend who owns a pub on this day. And, you know, I was in there a few weeks ago and I had a few drinks with Campbell. If you're from Hattersley, you get on great with people. Maybe if you're not from Hattersley, maybe a little bit different. But like the school that I was at, it's not there now. It's not down again. It had a reputation for being a rough school. Looking back, it was great.
What were you like at school? Were you well behaved? Were you disciplined? Did you enjoy school?
Never really enjoyed school. I like to think I did quite well at school with my GCSEs and stuff like that. But sounds a bit ignorant now, and a bit, I never used to try. I never used to try at school. I always knew I'd be a sportsman. And, I say to Jack now and to Campbell, always have a plan B, and I've always pushed that. I never did. I never had plan A was to be a sportsman. Was pretty good at most sports that I played. And I always had that belief that I was going to achieve it, I suppose, if you ask Ricky as well. He'd have probably said the same. My dad was a sportsman. He played for Manchester City. Again, we was always good at sports. Whatever sport we wanted to play, we was always generally good at it. So, you know, I was same at school. I was never in trouble at school, very rarely. And I was pretty good at school, but I just didn't try. I was pretty smart. I was pretty clued up. I mean, I was always friends with some of the smart kids and generally I'd copy their homework. One of the teachers, I think, was getting on my case, but I even spotted that and I used to copy his homework on the school bus. But sometimes I'd notice him getting the odd one right, so I'd copy most of it and I thought, oh, you got that wrong there. So that's how I was able to get away with that for years, I think.
Did you... You said you had this... you always had this plan in your head about being a sportsman. Mm. Did that mean that you were still a social kid, like you with other? Did you have a big friendship group, or because you had this singularity towards what you wanted to do as a career, were you a bit of a loner? What was the way?
No, we again, that was, I think when you live on a housing estate as it was, you do generally have that. We was out every night, really. A lot of the time was spent doing sports, and again, really grateful to my mum. Wherever we needed to be, they'd make sure we got there. But we was out on our bikes all around the estate most evenings, really. We're still friends with some of the kids that we used to knock around with now. But we used to do all sorts on the estate. And getting up to no good, no, I wouldn't say that. But, you know, yeah, just sort of like things what kids do. I mean, I was a little shit me when I was younger. My mum and dad will tell you that. I mean, we was only talking about this the other day. And we lived in the pub, and one of my neighbours, I really didn't get on with him, I really didn't like him. And I was sending her some hate mail for a little bit, posting him through. And we used to do a thing in the pub called the tote, where it was like numbers and stuff like that. And that I wasn't as smart as I thought, because that's how I got rumbled. I was posting the 8 letters in the tote envelopes. That's how I got rumbled. My mum was talking about that the other day, actually.
That's quite a funny story in a way. I mean, but... How did your mum and dad respond to that then? Were they disciplinary? I know you said that they were really good parents. Were they strict? Were they disciplinarians? An example like that, would they come down on you hard, or was it, you know?
I wouldn't say strict. I wouldn't, yeah. Both my mum and dad, not strict, but we couldn't mess about. You know, I got a few cracks off my dad. You know, I don't mind admitting it. I mean, it's not the way I am as a parent now. You know, I've never hit either of my two kids, and I don't think I generally would. But it certainly did me no harm, and Ricky. So I wouldn't say strict. I've touched on it already. My mum and dad were great parents. My childhood was nothing but fond memories, really. But yeah, I wouldn't say strict, but certainly no messing about. You know, if we stepped out of line, we knew about it.
Yeah. Yeah, you mentioned there that Ray, your dad was a top quality football player. Mm. Is this what led your first love in terms of sports to be football rather than boxing? Or would I be correct to say that?
Yeah, both me and Ricky were good footballers. Anybody will tell you that. And we started off with the kickboxing. Again, it was funny really, because there was no real boxing in the family. I know maybe generations ago, no real boxing in the family. My dad, you say, my dad was a good footballer. He played a few games for the first team at City, played for England schoolboys. So boxing come from nowhere, really. We started off kickboxing. Generally, I was the younger sibling, so I followed Ricky a lot of the time. We started off kickboxing originally, and then that eventually went into the boxing.
So how old were you when you and Ricky started the kickboxing then?
I was six when I had my first kickboxing, and I think, Jesus Christ, my mum and dad must have been tough on me, because I couldn't imagine my kids competing at six. I had my first kickboxing bout at six.
So I'm just trying to work it. So how old are you now, Matt?
I'm 42 now.
Right, so you grew up in a generation which is still classed as a generation where, it kind of old school in a sense, parents were different, you know, kids were a bit more rugged and tough,
yeah.
I suppose, compared to nowadays. Nowadays, you like to say a six-year-old wouldn't perhaps go into a full contact martial art because there's a stigma around it, for example. But do you actually feel that gave you the embedding that you needed to sort of toughen up and learn to be a bit street smart and everything?
Absolutely. Again, we do live in a snowflake society now. things have changed, some for the better, some for the worst. But yeah, we was brought up the right way, and again, as things got better, some things have got better, but I think generally you've got to be very careful what you say, what you do now. And I suppose even still now I'm doing my coaching and stuff like that, I've got a lot of those morals still in me, and I suppose I am still a little bit old school, really, and that's because I was brought up.
So you're 6 years old, you've got clocks for the first time in a kickboxing fight. Can you actually recall that, like what it was like?
I can, and it's, you know, it sounds, I loved it. It certainly never put me off, you know, still, again, it's just one of them things that's in you. I always like to compete, and I remember my first kickboxing bout, even though I was very young, I loved it.
Yeah, you've mentioned as well then that, you know, your parents looked after you well when you were young. These sort of clubs and external activities, they involve travel, they involve paying subs, etc. Your parents also had a carpet business, if I'm right.
Yeah.
So am I right in thinking that you always had enough money to do these types of things? It wasn't like a struggle, so to speak.
No, it wasn't. Me mum and dad always had a bit of money. They always done well. They always worked hard. Again, my dad had a carpet shop in Gorton. Again, quite a tough area. And I actually fitted carpets for my dad before I turned professional. When I left school for a couple of years, I did carpets for my dad. And again, some great stories there, you know. Again, sometimes people didn't want to pay and stuff like that. And, you know, I'm there, I was only young, but fitting carpets in and around the area. Fitted carpets in a brothel once at 17. So, experiences, should we say.
We got to touch on that. There's no way we can carry on this interview now without talking. I know we're jumping a few 10 years ahead here, but you fitted carpet in a brothel.
Oh, there was. Looking back, sometimes, you know, I remember one time we was fitting carpets in a house, and sometimes you know they'd go before paying.
Yeah.
My dad would say, "Don't leave that house till you get the money." Again, this brothel on Hyde Road in Gorton, fitting the carpets there. You can imagine some of the things that was going on. So again, experiences, and I suppose it's kept. Yeah, I like to think I'm pretty grounded. I think a lot of that's probably got a lot to do with it.
Yeah, well, we're definitely going to touch on that again after this interview's finished.
They were still paying 6 months later, so we had to keep calling in to get the instalments.
I bet you did.
I'm only joking, by the way.
Or is he? Now, of course, you've mentioned Ricky a couple of times. You know, he's starting to establish himself as somebody who's one to watch at this stage because he's got something, he's got a knack, and people are talking about him as potentially being a future star, you know, when he crosses over into the boxing at a young age. Is that something for you that spurred you on? Was there any jealousy involved, sibling rivalry? What was that dynamic like?
Spurred me on. Again, me and Ricky always had such a great relationship because we was always doing sport together as kids. We'd always go on holiday. And we got on famously, you know, as kids. We got on really, really well. There was never any jealousy from my part. Again, I was proud of what he did and then what he eventually went on to do. And I suppose it did inspire me and did push me on. You know, he was doing really well and I wanted some of that as well. So, yeah, you know, even though it was fairly tough, I suppose in a way it helped me get the best out of myself.
But his amateur career is well known, especially in the Manchester circuits. You speak to anyone you speak to people like Jamie Moore, you speak to people like Arnie Farnell, and they tell you stories of Ricky coming up as an amateur, knocking kids out with body shots and doing, which is quite a rare occurrence. He definitely had something there. So what was your experience of your early amateur career and how did it parallel and what did you feel like you learned and picked up in your early amateur career?
Well, I only had 22 amateur fights, but again, I had a little bit of, obviously, I had 22 kickboxing bouts as well, so I had a little bit of pedigree there. And I only had 22 amateur contests, but I was boxing at a good level. even in them 22. I won five of my first six fights. And I think it was in my ninth bout, I boxed Thomas McDonough, who was a multi-time national champion. And I got drawn against him. It was either the junior ABAs or the boys' clubs. And when I agreed to the fight and accepted the fight, I think people were surprised. But I beat him. And then I fought a guy called Stephen Birch, who was another really experienced, you know, England representative, multi-time nationals. So even by the time I'd had 9, 10, 11 fights, I was boxing pretty much at the top end, even in the amateurs. I won the novice ABAs. But it was a little bit stop-start for me when I was doing the amateurs. I had a few fights, then I had a little break. I was doing other things. I was playing cricket. I used to love my cricket. I was a good footballer. That spent a lot of my time. So it was a little bit stop-start, the boxing. But then I suppose I started taking it more serious about 15, 16. Wasn't quite enjoying my football. Still a good player, but I just enjoyed the boxing more.
Yeah, you mentioned people like Thomas McDonough there in the amateurs. Of course, he was an incredibly hard style to box because he was so elusive, especially, well, more so in his professional career as well. But are you picking things up? Are you learning things, not just physically, but mentally about the game as you're going through this period of time? And are you finding that the sport is more of a mental sport than you thought?
Absolutely. And again, Ricky was doing well at the time, so I'd always have good sparring and stuff like that. We were both really strong kids. Again, I think that was come from playing sports from an early age. Both really fit and very competitive too. You know, I was a terrible loser. When we used to go away on holiday, you know, you'd have these little tournaments around the hotels and stuff like that. People generally wouldn't play me because I was a terrible loser. Again, as it gone on, I still am today. I hate losing. It doesn't matter whether I'm in the corner with someone. I really hate losing. And again, that was from how we was brought up. It was always competitive. And I know we don't live in that kind of world now, like sports day, there's no winner and loser. It's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. So again, it was more competitive then, and I'm glad I was brought up in that era. And that's how I teach my kids to be competitive. Yeah, it's nice to take part, but if you're going to do it, play to win.
Completely agree with that. That's why I try and raise my kids as well. You've mentioned there about sort of you took it more seriously when you were about 15, 16. Did that come a point where you had to make certain social sacrifices when you realised, actually, I want to take this sport a bit more seriously? Did that conversation ever come up at that stage?
Yeah, and I was playing football. I stopped playing football at 16, 17, just because I could see boxing was what I enjoyed and my future. And we was always training. Pushed, by my mum and dad. Pushed to train to get the best out of ourselves. So yeah, I think you do when you are training, you do miss certain social events and stuff like that. But me and our kids certainly made up for it in between, which is well known.
It's well known, isn't it? Were there any particular influences that influenced that your amateur career? Are there any specific people you look back at and think, yeah, you had a big influence on how I developed as a fighter?
Not really. And you know, I started off at Sale West with Mr. Dunn, and I eventually ended up going to Mottram and Hattersley. Purely, Sale West was a great amateur club. I wish I could have stayed there, to be honest, but once I started doing a little bit of work as well, it was just the distance. And, you know, we lived on Hattersley. I eventually started boxing for Mottram and Hattersley. So, no, again, I didn't have a vast amateur experience, really. I only had 22 contests. With hindsight, I wish I'd have stayed longer. I should have stayed longer. But it was what it was.
So you had 22 amateur fights. You won 18 of them.
Yes,
it's a really good record going into the pros. You're at that juncture now where you're thinking, well, I'm going to stop fitting carpets at the brothel, and I'm going to move into professional boxing. So, choosing a trainer is always quite a, it's quite a, an interest. You've got a big name still when you're turning over. There's probably a lot of trainers who are interested in training you. How did you decide, and what thought process did you go through, and what influence did you go through to actually establish who you would have as a professional boxing trainer?
It was fairly easy, to be honest, because Ricky was at Billy Graham's gym at the time. I was doing quite well as an amateur, and Billy used to let me go down and train. So again, that helped as well. I was only 16, 17, but I'd go down to Billy's Phoenix camp, do a little bit of training there, did some sparring with some of the professionals as well. Used to do a bit of sparring with my brother, with us being around the same weights. So that certainly helped me boxing education, me boxing knowledge, and toughen me up, because, you know, it's the full circle of boxing. You know, you see these kids, and I was one of those. You're going into a professional gym, and a lot of time you're getting second prize. And then as you get later in your career, more experience, you smile because you remember, you know, the kids coming into the amateurs, you know, they come down and stuff like that, and you think, yeah, that used to be me. You're getting some of that today.
So you walk into the gym, you meet Billy Graham. You've already met him before previously, but what are your early impressions of Billy as a trainer, and why did you feel it would work?
Just because of the good fighters that were in the gym. And again, I was very fortunate. Again, I didn't have much of an amateur experience. I only had 22 amateur fights. So I said, look, we've got to do it properly. So my dad gave me 6 months. Again, lucky, fortunate, give me 6 months. Just concentrate on my boxing. I stopped the carpet fitting. I had no money. Whatever money I needed, I lent off my dad. I paid him back after I'd had a few first professional fights. So again, that helped me. Not the most experienced amateurs, but I was doing a lot of sparring with professionals, some great fighters in the gym. Obviously, Billy was a very, very experienced trainer. And so, yeah, that was how it started off for me.
The Phoenix gym there's a few in Manchester, but it's one of those gyms that it's kind of iconic in a sense, you know. You mentioned some of the top fighters that were there. When you joined the gym as a professional, which fighters were in and around there? And were there any that sort of you looked at, you saw spars with, or you saw them training, you thought, wow?
Yeah, obviously my brother, Carl Thompson was training there at the time, Ensley Bingham. So some big names, and I had plenty of people to look at. Again, it was a busy gym, it was a thriving gym, people coming in and out. But they were the fighters that, again, just chatting about it now, that stuck in my head. It was watching Michael Brody, another one. Mm-hmm. Really, really good Manchester fighters.
These are quality fighters you're talking about. So when you walk in as you're sort of like the young puppet, so to speak, do they take you under their wing, or is it a bit more, you've got to prove yourself first?
Yeah, no, it was good. They was all good with me, as Billy was, Carl, Ensley. They was all helping me out, giving little pointers, Michael Brody and people like that. So no, again, and when you're mixing around quality like that, that's how you learn most things, isn't it? Just by watching and observing. And I've never been one of these people, I don't mind asking people, you know, I don't mind asking for help and advice and stuff like that. And I was always picking people's brains throughout my career, really.
Yeah. Were you thinking at this stage about promoters you'd like to work with? Were you thinking about that?
The way it panned out for me, it was all quite straightforward because of Ricky was doing well. Ricky was with Frank Warren at the time. Obviously, they spoke to Frank when I was turning professional. I'd just won the novice ABAs. He had a good record. You know, he was obviously getting good reports. So again, it wasn't really. It was I was signed to Frank Warren straight away.
So are you quite thankful then that Ricky was paving this way? Because it sounds like you had a good natural progression set up, which you may not have had if Ricky hadn't been going through the ranks just before you and being so successful.
100%. I always say that. Like you say, the pathway there, got these opportunities. Of course, it's a double-edged sword. You know, as the fights get on, there's more pressure, you're more in the spotlight. Everyone you're fighting tries that little bit harder because of who I was. Even then, Ricky was doing well, had a big reputation. But yeah, no, lucky sort of like to go into such a great gym and to be, you know, he was the biggest and best promoter then. And I'm straight in on Frank Warren's show. So, yeah, grateful for that. Absolutely.
And any sort of gym wars or things that stick out, you know, before you sort of turn pro, when you're sort of learning the ropes, and any sort of spars that you look back and think, well, that was a good spar?
The biggest one was my brother.
Was it?
I used to take some lickings off him, I'll tell you.
He didn't hold back when he sparred you?
Oh, no. And we were both living at home at the time. And sometimes I'd come in and I'd have a shine and stuff like that. My mum would be like, what are you doing to him? I remember one time he had a new head guard on, and the head guard was just turning and turning and turning. Can sometimes happen with new equipment. And the head guard moved across my face, and he whacked me in the back. I'm sure it did some serious damage to me back, because it bothered for me for the earliest part of my career, to be fair. So, no, I was always tough. I've always been tough, and I used to spar a lot with my brother, and I think Billy spotted that, and Billy realised that, and he'd have me sparring with a lot of the bigger guys, a lot of the more experienced guys, because he knew I could. I suppose it kept his job easy as well. I think that sort of like didn't really, it helped me in a certain way, but again, it held me back in a certain way. But it certainly improved my defence. It certainly toughened me up. But I had some really hard, tough spars because I could.
When you say it may have held you back in a certain way, what do you mean by that?
I think for me, and again, what I try and do with my fighters, I think it's important to get the balance. You want your tough spars where you're up against it. It toughens you up. You know, it's a tough sport. But then you need your spars again where you can let your own hands go, you can try things. And I never really got much of that, to be honest. I was always in at the deep end. And I think eventually it turned me into the fighter that I become.
Well, you made your professional debut in 2000.
That's right, yeah.
On one of Ricky's undercards, actually. Giuseppe Lowry, I think it was.
Yeah.
I think that was the fight. So what are your recollections of turning professional? You've finally got to this stage now, which seems like your whole life seems to have been pointing you in this direction. Mm. Like the universe has decided this is your direction. You've gone and made it happen. What are your recollections of professional debut?
Very nervous. I remember my first amateur fight. I was crying. I didn't want to come out. It was a bit more old school. Then Mr. Dunn twisted me by the ear, grabbed me, said, get out there. And then again, did okay in the amateurs. But I was very, very nervous for my professional debut. And once I got that out of the way, the nerves eased. I've always been quite a relaxed fighter, but I just remember being very, very nervous for that fight. Again, it was on Ricky's undercard. It was a big bill. It was at the York Hall, Bethnal Green. And I fought a tough Welsh lad. He was having his pro debut as well. So I actually boxed him twice in my first two fights. But it was a cracking little tear-up. It was a really entertaining fight both times. Not an easy debut, baptism into the professional game. But I always remember it, and it was a great night for me.
When you say you struggled with nerves for that particular fight, how did you learn to overcome that? Because a lot of boxers do struggle with nerves, even if they don't admit it. When they retire, they admit it, that they struggled with nerves. What coping mechanisms and strategies did you use?
It was bizarre. It was just that first one, just that professional debut. I've never been the most... Every fighter gets nervous. You know, if they're not getting nervous before a fight, there's something wrong with them. Because people generally say, as the fights get harder, get tougher, do the nerves increase? No, you sort of like learn as you go along. You get more experience, more confident, and you learn how to deal with it. You know, preparation's always important to me. I know if I prepare well and I work hard, that gives me confidence. So it was just that first fight. I remember it. I remember it well, but very, very nervous. That's the one thing that sticks in my mind about that one.
You went your first 13 fights unbeaten. You're picking up experience. You're boxing in different venues. What in your early professional career do you feel like you what was the deciding thing that you felt you learnt the most? You know, was there an experience you learnt the most from in those first 13 fights?
I remember I've always been very critical of myself, and I remember about the early part of my professional career, I didn't really enjoy it. And that sounds silly because I was fighting and I was winning, but I was always very critical of myself. And like I say, I won my first 13 fights, then I suffered a couple of defeats. I was getting a hell of a lot of criticism as well because Ricky was an established fighter. Ricky was doing so well. Not quite as prevalent on social media back then, but I used to get a lot of criticism. And I remember in the early stage, I just wasn't enjoying me, but even when I was winning and performing well, I was always very critical. And then I lost a couple of fights and, you know, I thought, what's the problem? And I thought, you know what? I'm not enjoying my boxing. I just need to relax, enjoy it. What will be, will be. I've already lost a couple of fights. I've already suffered criticism. And from that moment on, the shackles really come off. It must have been really holding me back because once I took that outlook, my career started taking off then. Me performances got better and better. I eventually moved from Billy Graham's gym. I started working with Lee Beard, who sort of like put, you know, even though Billy had a busy gym, a lot of his time and effort were going into Ricky. One by one, the fighters were leaving. The last one to leave was actually me. And I probably should have left Billy's gym a little bit earlier. And that's nothing, no disrespect to Billy at all. I just wasn't getting the work and I needed the work. You know, I was inexperienced. So I needed the work more than others.
You mentioned there about getting criticism. Mm. That's something that a lot of fighters struggle with in today's society. You've mentioned, I mean, social media's moved on a lot since when you were boxing, but still, are you talking about it was papers, it was, you know, on websites, it was like written reports and you were reading into this and tell us about how that sort of impacted you like emotionally.
Yeah, it was tough and, you know, yeah, it was more papers and magazine than I remember people writing me off saying that Matt wouldn't even box for a British title. And again, great fuel, though. And I remember I'd lost a couple of fights to fighters that I shouldn't. Quite embarrassing defeats, to be honest.
Because your 14th fight you lost, it was a journeyman you lost.
That's right, yeah. And I was embarrassed about it, very embarrassed. Lost to some fighters that I shouldn't have lost to. And, you know, you're getting your reporters saying this, that and the other. And again, it was great fuel for me. And I remember at the time I'm walking around and I always believed in myself. And people say, what's the ambition? What's the goal? We say he was doing interviews and stuff like, oh, I want to be a world champion. And you could see him, they're thinking, you know, he's dead here, Matt. He's deluded. You know, he's lost to him. But I always believed in myself. And the criticism I got was great fuel for me and was able to push me forward.
Did you ever come face to face with anyone who'd written something about you and, you know, ask them about it, query why they'd written that, or were you more of a person who just sort of liked to observe?
Yeah, just observe, really. And in the end, I let my boxing do the talking. And so, no, not really. I can't really remember any circumstances where I was pointing out to people what they were actually saying.
You got yourself in a position where you fought. I want to touch on this fight because I actually watched it last night and it was really, I hadn't seen it before. It was a British title fight eliminator that you fought with Alan Bosworth. Mm. And this was quite a controversial fight because you were disqualified by referee Howard Foster in this fight.
Mm. Still not forgiving. I'm only joking, though. I get on well with Howard now. He's a good referee and a good official. But I was fuming at the time. Yeah. I was fuming.
I could see. you were fuming. To be honest, I would have been fuming because realistically, I watched the fight and then I was trying to pick up where I could actually see is why, because you were disqualified for an accumulation of low blows and a hitting on the break, but some of them were borderline and 50-50. And what do you think, what were you thinking as this fight was going on?
It was one of those things where it was an intense atmosphere. It was in Sheffield and it was a fight I dominated, really. I absolutely dominated the fight. It was a rough fight. Bosworth wasn't a great boxer and, you know, he would try and bend the rules and it got quite physical. But I was a lot better, I was a lot stronger and I sort of like beat him at his own game, really. I should have probably outboxed him and stuff like that. I was well ahead in the fight. I was absolutely well ahead in the fight. And then, like you say, Howard disqualified me in the last round, and it all kicked off in the crowd. I think my mum tried to crack Howard with her handbag. It all kicked off because I actually remember Dennis Hobson. He got in because he was quite bad. Yeah. He got in the ring and he said, "Matt, he said you need to have a word with your fans here. You need to get on the mic. Can you swear?"
Yeah.
I said, "You're fucking joking, aren't you?" I said, "I hope they fucking wreck the place." And I've stormed out of the ring. I was fuming. And when I look back on the fight and watch it, I'm like, wow, what did I do? Why didn't I just keep my head that last round? Mm. But he was coming to the end of his tether. What I do think I was on the verge of stopping him. I remember I was quite critical, actually, to Billy and Ricky at the time. I told them the week that they should have calmed me down and stuff like that. But they could see we were gone and they wanted me to finish him. You know, both attacking fighters and coaches. So yeah, not fond memories, that one. But again, I put it behind me, and one thing I've always had is persistence and stubborn. I stuck with it, and I always had that belief that I'd get there one day.
You stuck with it. You went the IBF route. You ended up going like the IBF route, and you think you fought. You started fighting in America on some of Ricky's undercards, and I mean, was that a culture shock going to America, traveling, seeing the way that they approach boxing? Because obviously, you're a traditional English lad, basically, and you're going to America. It's a different culture. They're a lot more, they're a bit brash when it comes to the boxing. It's more of a show. Mm. What were your early experiences of going over to America?
Some of the fondest memories of my life, really was. I loved it, going over there for training camps, going to different gyms, working with different trainers. Again, very lucky. To be boxing on Ricky's undercard, you know what I mean, on these huge bills, on the great stages, being fortunate to go to different gyms, work with different trainers, has all helped in me boxing knowledge and education, and it certainly helped me in my fighting days as well, but great, great times.
Were there any particular trainers that you went over and saw, or any particular gyms that you have a specific memory about in those American adventure, let's say?
Yeah, I mean, I remember going in the top rank gym one time, and I think you heard Kerry talking about it, and there was a bit of, we ended up going in the UFC gym at an event, but there was a bit of hostility there, and I think the reason behind it, I'm not too sure. I mean, it was a gym full of fighters, everyone had the top off and stuff like that. I took my top off to train, it was really hot. They told me I had to put mine back on, and there was a bit of a vibe there. But again, I sparred with lots of, I couldn't name the fighters, you know, but I used to train and spar over there a lot, and it was really good. I worked with different trainers, Floyd Mayweather Sr., Brother Nazim, Richardson. Again, so very fortunate, really. Boxed all over the world, fought all over the world, trained all over the world, different environments, different countries. And, you know, 52 professional, I've learned a hell of a lot, you know, a lot of knowledge over the years. And I think that helps me now with the coaching in my 52 fights. There's not much I haven't seen or done firsthand as well. Mm. So, great times over in the States, so really was.
Well, you've mentioned some serious names there, you know, the likes of Mayweather Sr. and Nazim Richardson. Mm. I'll just take a little segue then and talk about that before we come back to your career specifically. You're obviously involved in these massive fights, massive undercards of Ricky's as well. You know, you've told me, this was a while ago, you told me about encounters with Floyd Mayweather, and you know he even ended up inviting you to his house, didn't he, like later on after Ricky and him had retired.
Yeah.
What was it like being around these massive characters, and particularly like Floyd Mayweather, because he was a star that sort of transcended boxing?
Some crazy stories, you know. I'm looked back now on it. I smile. I remember when I won the IBF international title in, it was at the Paris Hotel, and I fought a guy called Franco Taylink. So generally after my fights, I'd always like to go into the changing rooms and speak to the fighters, get a picture after. And I went into his changing room after, and they were putting the cuffs on him. They nicked him.
Really?
Literally straight after the fight. And then I was speaking to a policeman after the fight, and I was like, wow, I didn't think his performance were that bad. But he, they said, oh no, he's up for some quite serious charges. I think he had sort of like a bit of a racketeering thing going on, some fraud to do with like. So he said, well, it's a little bit different over here. You know, we knew where he was going to be. We let him fight. He gets paid, and we'll be taking that purse now. And again, sort of like, remember after Ricky fought Mayweather, you know, we was in Hooters actually. We was on the thingy and they said, oh, Floyd's been on the phone. He wants to know if you want to come to his house today. You know what our kids like, he'd had a few Guinness by the time, and he was like, what do I want to go to that tosser's house for? So, but you'll know yourself, there's some characters and there's some mad stuff goes in boxing. There is no other sport like it, like you say, where the guy's getting nicked there straight after the fight. And there's just so many stories over the years. I look back really fun, great times.
I mean, it's a lot of international travel. You're flying here, you're flying around. I mean, just not even just boxing, but you're getting to experience the world. And not everyone from Council Estates in Hattersley would have got to experience.
Well, I boxed in Monaco as well.
Yeah, Monaco. And that's the richest place, isn't it? One of the richest places on the planet, I think.
Yeah. Boxed over there, boxed all over the world. But yeah, a lot of happy times over in the States.
Is that international travel something that... you actually want to pass on to your own children, because it's something which you get to see the world, and it's so much more accessible now. But back then, you're seeing all these things. Is that something that sticks with you?
Absolutely, and that's why I'm keen for Campbell to do the same now. You know, I went over and trained in the States and stuff like that, spent a lot of time out there, and I think that's something that would benefit Campbell as well. So, you know, we're just looking at doing something like that for him, because I look back and it helped me. And I want to give Campbell or any of my fighters, if I've got the opportunity for them to get that experience. And it's a good experience, not just for the boxing, in the life experiences as well. So if they've got the potential and the ability to travel, then why not?
Absolutely. Just come back to your sort of career at the minute, because you just mentioned there, you know, you left Billy Graham, you went to train with Lee Beard, who was, I think he was an assistant coach of Ricky at the time as well. Was that a tough decision? Because when fighters leave trainers, there's always that awkward phase, or you've got to have a conversation, or it can sometimes be a murky sort of transition. What was the transition like? Was it awkward? Was it a clean transition?
Yeah, it was fairly. I mean, I felt bad because one by one, the fighters were leaving. You know, Ricky was getting a lot of the attention. Ricky was getting a lot of Billy's time, and the other fighters weren't getting the time they needed. So one by one, they were leaving. And I was the last one to go. I didn't want to leave because I didn't want to leave Rick there on his own, and we was always so close. But in the end, you know, I had to do what was right by me. And I wish, from my own boxing point of view, I'd have done it that little bit sooner, but was what it was. But yeah, it was like you say, Lee was the assistant coach. He was helping out and stuff like that. I was doing more and more with Lee, spending more time together, become good friends. And again, when I sort of left that gym, again, with that different mindset as well, relaxing more, enjoying my boxing more, and having a coach putting the time and effort into me, and who believed in me as well, which is important. Again, my career got better and better.
You mentioned that some of the catalyst towards that point for you leaving was some of the fights you had and losses you had. I know one of the ones that, perhaps I've always got the impression that you were quite disappointed was the Commonwealth title loss to Craig Watson.
Yeah.
Why does that one? Because a couple of times I've sort of noticed that, you know, that one kind of stuck with you a little bit. Is there any particular reason?
It was a big night. It was for the Commonwealth title. It was a big arena, big crowd, and I got comprehensively outboxed by Craig Watson. I'll be the first to admit that. And sometimes it takes something like that to happen for you to make the move, and that is eventually when I did move. But yeah, an embarrassing defeat, not because Craig was a good fighter, just a poor, poor performance, and I was very embarrassed about that. I realised that I needed to make changes, and I did.
your career does start to go on a much more of an upward trajectory after the move, particularly really good win against Bentaki. But you, wins over Bami, you had a draw with Ludmore and Doo, and eventually you sort of you could see in your performances that you're coming on. What do you actually put? You've mentioned about relaxing more and enjoying the boxing. Was there technical things that you feel you were picking up which changed the way you boxed?
Yeah, Lee was a very technical coach. He still is. Really improved me defensive work, which was never the best. And I think I got more professional as I got older. I always looked up to Ricky, and I watched how Ricky did things. And I wished I'd have looked after myself a little bit better as well. Early in my career, I was fighting very regular. But obviously, well documented how Ricky used to live his life. You know, going out, partying and stuff like that, which I did myself. And then I sort of like, I found my own way, my own path. I went with Lee, spending more time apart. I realised me lifestyle, my diet. Like Ricky, I used to put on a lot of weight in between me fights, and crazy really. And as my career went on, I got more professional. I was always on weight. I was always fit. I was always working on my game. And that was why I was able to box for the European title. 2 weeks' notice, 12 rounds against a top fighter. And early in my career, I wouldn't have been able to do that. But I learned as I went on. I got better as I went on. I lived my life better as I went on. And I realised that was the way to do it. Combine that with better coaching as well. And that's why my results and performances started to improve. I've no doubt about that.
Well, when you fought Branko for the European title, I think he was 43-2 or something like that, one draw. He had a formidable record. You were actually expected to lose the fight. He was an underdog going into the fight. If I remember correctly, you sustained an injury in the first round, didn't you? Did you break your jaw in the first round? Was that a different fight?
That was a different fight. Right. That was my first defence.
Right.
Like you say, Branko was ageing. But he'd only lost to Miguel Cotto and Arturo Gatti. They were the two defeats on his record, so it wasn't a gimme because even after I beat Branko, defended it twice, he had another spell as European champion. So even though he was aging, he was a great, great fighter. But by this stage in my career, I'd learned, I'd live my life better, and I was always ready.
Do you see that fight as the pinnacle of your boxing career?
I do, because generally the fight that people want to talk about is the Canelos, the Kell Brook fights. But that was a great night for me because all these people that wrote me off, wrote articles, he won't even fight for the British title. Again, like I said it earlier, it was great fuel for me. And it was a sweet, sweet moment when I won that European title. And something I'm really proud of. I still wanted to go on and be a world champion. If things panned out a little bit better, I could have been. But I don't regret it. But that night, it was such a sweet moment because of all the criticism that I'd received.
So it was almost like vindication, was it?
Absolutely, yeah. Vindication. Yeah. And sort of like I always believed in myself as well. Vindication for myself as well.
Does it annoy you that when people talk to you about your career, a lot of it focuses on the fights you lost?
Yeah.
Does it annoy you?
Not really. No, it doesn't. You know, generally the fight people will want to talk about is the Canelo fight. But I don't think I really got the appreciation that I deserved when I was fighting. But I think I've said it to you before. Now that I've retired, I think people don't care quite as much about, you know, when you sat on the shelf and stuff like that. But when you look back on my career now, the people who have fought, undefeated European champion, fought some great, great fighters. People are pretty generally quite complimentary to me about my career now, so that's nice.
Well, sorry to have to talk about the Canelo fight, but it's such an interesting fight because I stayed up to watch this fight live at the time, but I remember thinking, well, did anyone ever try and talk you out of taking this fight, because you're in there with this young kid, Canelo. He's 35-0 when you fight him. He's a banger. He's built up as a superstar. You're going on his platform. You know you're not going to get a fair shake, even if it was close. He's not bothered to make the weight, actually, even at the weigh-in, which is another thing. But did anyone even try and put you off it, or was it always a case of they thought you could pull off this miracle win?
Do you know what? It was one of those things. I'd already had a lot of fights by then, and I was generally quite a strong character, and not many people could talk me into things or away from things. I had quite, I'd had a lot of fights then already, and I wanted to fight the best people for the best money. It was as simple as that. I always wanted to test myself against the top fighters. I was sort of like managing myself. I did manage myself at the back end of my career, but I was sort of like already then, I was calling a lot of the shots myself, so there was nobody gonna... Did it work for me? Probably not, with hindsight, which is a great thing. I think if it had taken a little bit of an easier path, I could have probably been a world champion, but I was always up for the challenge. As soon as that fight put for me, he was the next up-and-coming superstar. Everyone was raving about him. A great show over there. And again, I didn't win the fight. It was a tough fight. But again, I look back on him, great experiences. He never made the weight, of course. But again, a fight that, going on to see what he's achieved and stuff like that, I look back. And again, just the time over there, he enjoyed it. Great memories for me, and I'm proud of my performance that night.
I think it's definitely aged well, that performance. Mm. I mean, at the time, you are getting comprehensively beat by him, but it did knock you from pillar to post, in all fairness. But you proved to many people who hadn't seen you by then, just that's when you can talk about, like the Chris Eubank senior talked about the warrior code and that sort of thing. I think that personified it. I think that's why often, I know you lost the fight, but often people come back to that. So in defeat, was it a proud moment in defeat, going 12 rounds with this guy who, and you went toe-to-toe with him?
Mm. I never stopped trying to win. And I still believed all the way through the fight that I could win. And I never stopped trying. I got second prize, and it was a tough, tough, hard night's work. He was a very, very good fighter even then, and I literally knew it straight away. So much bigger than me as well, so much heavier on the night. And again, when I look back on my career, 52 fights, never stopped. I lost one fight early in my career on a cut eye, but I was always tough. I always used to tell people no one had knocked me out. And I used to tell my friends that even when I was young. I'm proud, and like I say, 52 fights. Never stopped, and when you look at the level of opposition that I faced, something else that I'm proud of.
Some of the body shots he landed in that fight, he was quite—he's a very vicious fighter, actually, because he thinks about it and he really tries to break down an opponent. He's class at doing it. Some of those body shots he landed on you—he'd stopped very, very good kids with the same sorts of body shots. What's it actually like to feel a punch from Canelo? What's is it different from other fighters? Because this is a big jump, step up in levels.
It was. I mean, literally in the first round, he leaped at me with a left hook, and I blocked it on the forearm. And I remember thinking to myself, Jesus Christ, this is going to be a long, hard, tough fight. And it was. And I remember going back to the hotel after the fight, and I didn't feel great, and literally the next day, it was like I'd been in a car crash. It was a tough, tough night, and did it take a little bit away from me, that fight? Probably. Again, but that's the reality of boxing. Took a lot of shots in that fight, and I took them, I withstood them, and it probably did take a little bit away from me, I think.
There is footage of you actually going back to the dressing room that night. It's on YouTube somewhere. I'm sure there is footage of you coming back.
I still had my wits about. I remember being laid down there and the doctor's stitching me up. And my mum says some random things, don't you? She said something like that. And I remember like just lay there like that. And I said something like, what do you want them to do? Stick it together with sellotape. But yeah, it was a tough night, it was. And, you know, these 12-round fights, Kell Brook was another one. Tough. You know, tough on the mind, tough on the body. And again, probably towards the back end of my career, remembering them experiences, I'd had my children by this stage as well, and had my family and stuff like that, which I think softens you. And no, it's a tough sport, it is.
Yeah, the Kell Brook fight, you definitely did break something in the first round, didn't you? Broke your nose?
Yeah, broken nose.
You broke your nose, yeah.
Again, I don't really have many regrets on my boxing career, but that fight was one of them. Do I think I could have beat Kell Brook? In reality, no. He was a better fighter than me. He was a special fighter, actually, Kell Brook. But he broke my nose first round. And I remember that fight really sticks in my head. In all my time in the ring, that was the most pain I'd ever been in. My nose went first round. A good fighter, brilliant timing, good power puncher as well. And I remember literally after about two or three rounds, the blood was coming from my nose. It was almost like black, the blood. It was that. Mick Williamson said it was actually one of the worst injuries he'd seen. But I never had any quit in me. Did I think for quitting one for at one? No, it just wasn't in my nature to do that. But I remember being in absolute agony for that fight. I remember after about three or four rounds, I just wanted the fight. I was never going to quit, but I wanted the fight to be over. It was all a bit of a blur, the back end of the round, just purely because of the pain. So that is one of the big regrets in my career, because it was a big night, a big occasion, a big fight, and I was capable of giving so much more. It was just the hand that was dealt on the night.
I mean, big fights and defeats like that can often break people psychologically. I mean, Ricky's openly spoken about losses to Mayweather and Pacquiao, which sent him into a spiral of depression, even to Shevchenko loss. You didn't seem to, after big defeats, you didn't seem to sort of fall into that depressive zone, or did you? I mean, I don't know. Did you fall into that zone at any time?
No. I think even with my defeats, like I say, I'm a proud person and a stubborn person. I always have been, but I would imagine it, if I would have ever got stopped or knocked out, I would have taken that very badly. So I know exactly where Rick is coming from there when he talks about that, and other fighters. You know, say you're outside the pub and you have a rumble with someone and you get stuck on your ass, it's embarrassing. So for it to happen in front of millions of people, sometimes on TV, must be hard to take. And fortunate that never happened to me, because I imagine I would have taken it badly.
As a brother, when you see your brother go through that type of low, can you talk to us a little bit about that? What was it like seeing Ricky at very low points like that? And what was your relationship like during those periods of time?
It was awful, really. I mean, from the Manny Pacquiao fight, which was a bad defeat, a terrible knockout, just of experiencing that firsthand. And, you know, he had his problems with depression after that fight. And the area where we live, everyone knows each other, so people were speaking to us. We knew exactly, you know, some of the states he was getting himself into. He'd fallen out with my mum and dad at the time, which, you know, people used to love that early on in the early stages of the career, how close we was. And sometimes that can be a little bit of an act for the TV and stuff. That's how we was. And I think people like that. And then obviously at the time, you know, Ricky wasn't getting on with my mum and dad, which obviously I inevitably ended up getting part of that. You know, I didn't speak to Ricky for some time and stuff like that, which was, it was nothing to do with me. All of that, he fell out with me, but I got sucked in. So yeah, tough times, it really was.
Yeah, there was a catalogue of things, wasn't there? You've mentioned the defeats, and you mentioned obviously the fallout, which is well documented with your parents. You, as a brother, were you sort of like a, were you in the middle? Were you sort of in the middle, or that must have been quite hard for you as well. Could you let us know how you felt about that?
It was tough times, and you know, he didn't speak to my mum and dad for a lot of years.
It was 8 years.
Yeah, it seems crazy now. And I remember I was sort of like getting suckered in and sort of like getting involved myself and stuff like that. And I remember one day, just randomly, I think I'd not seen him for about 6 months or something like that. And I thought, what's all this got to do with me? And I just, one day I was just sat in my car, and he wasn't living in his house at the time. He was in another house in G Cross. I found out, I spoke to one of his friends. They told me where he was living. And I thought, I'm going down. And I remember knocking on the window, and I stood away from the door because I thought if he sees it's me, he might not answer. So I knocked on his door. He let me in, and I went, Rick, I said, what's all this got? Why are we not speaking and stuff like that? You know, it's nothing, difference with money, nothing to do with me, blah, blah, blah. And we spoke, and we put it right from that moment on. And even though he didn't speak to me dad for some period after that, at least we was getting on. And, you know, was that a way of him making it up with my mum and dad eventually? Maybe, maybe not. But tough times, really, really was, especially when you're getting all these stories about things he's doing and states he's in, you know, from different people. It was worrying, it really was, when you consider how close he was as well.
What was that moment like when you buried the hatchet, like when you sort of, I'm assuming, like hugged it out and just, you know, what was that moment like for you?
Great, like a weight was lifted off my shoulder, because again, we'd always been so close, you know, he was doing really, really well. But there was never, ever that resentment there from my side. And that's the God's honest truth. I was always so proud of him. And we was brought, we always did sport together. We were like best friends as kids and stuff like that. Even after our fights, you'd always see in the pub, we'd always go out, socialise together. And from being so close, like say, to not speaking for a long time, it was like a weight was lifted off my shoulder, it really was.
And then, of course, and I know Ricky's very, so emotional, but I went to see him actually do a stand-up talking. And, you know, he spoke about the sort of reunion with his parents quite emotionally. I think he actually was close to tears talking about it. And I know he has been off the camera as well, you know, when he says about making up with family. When he actually made up with your mum and dad, I know that was such a big moment for them as well. Like, you know, what was that like for you? Was that almost like, all right, this jigsaw is now complete now, the family's back together?
Yeah, it was great. You know, I used to see it on the social media and they were going out. Like, and again, when we're together, we have such a laugh. You know, sometimes I remember in COVID, we'd come here and we'd have a few drinks and we'd be talking about stories that happened in the pub years ago and stuff like that. And when we're together, we have, I'm glad there's no cameras around actually, because some of the story and some of the thing, we have such a great laugh. And we missed that. And it was great, really was.
Has there been a lot of, like, making up for lost time since then?
Yeah. And they were doing stuff together, going out for meals and stuff like that. And it was just great to see. And it sounds ridiculous when they didn't speak for that many years, when we was all together again, having a meal or going to the pub. It was like things had never changed.
Does that reinforce to you the sort of importance in family? And does that, when you're sort of bringing up your own kids and when you're with your own partner and you've got your own family life, does that always at the back of your mind, just to make sure you keep on top of things and keep that the relationship strong and the communication open?
Yeah. I had great parents, my mum and dad. And myself and Jenna, you know, we've got two great kids and I'm proud of what we do. We literally don't stop running about for our kids. It's absolutely non-stop. Lola's well into a football now. Jack's doing very, very well with his boxing. And that's how my mum and dad was with me, and that's how I'm going to be for my kids. The most important role I have now is to be a good dad, and I am, you know, and I've got a good partner in Jenna. She's great now. I call her the mummager now. She's getting right into the boxing with Jack. She's dead supportive. Lola's just signed for Stockport County, doing well with her. So, yeah, I suppose it's amazing how you learn now how your upbringing impacts your own life. You know, that's what my mum and dad did for me. And that's what I'm doing for my kids now.
Yeah, it's an important point. I mean, especially when, I suppose, the father role, the parenting role, that's getting, as society moves on, it's this getting more and more of a disconnect between that role. And we've talked before about sort of like the, you coming from an old school era, just yeah. about, you know, where,
yeah.
and same with me, that sort of era. You know, how have you noticed that society changing that way? And do you think that actually might impact young boxers coming through, not having as good a solid family base? How important is it for boxing?
It is. I was literally saying this the other day. It is so important for fighters to have that support network, and can make such a difference. I know it did for me. You see it. I work with some young kids now, and so important to have that support network behind you. And like I say, Jack, you know, I'm very supportive. His mum's so supportive. And, you know, it really does help. You need that. You really do. You need that.
This next question's a bit cheeky, I think. But, you know, financially speaking, when it comes to boxing, a lot of people are actually advised, look, boxing, unless you get top level, don't bother, because it's a hard sport for... What was your biggest payday?
Canelo.
Yeah.
Again, I'm glad it happened now, because when I look back at it, I think my original purse, I was getting underpaid when I look back on it. Yeah. But what happened with the Canelo fight, we was contracted to fight. Originally, I accepted the fight at welterweight when the fight was first put to me.
For the WBC world title, right?
No, what happened, I was originally fighting him in a 10-rounder at 147 pounds. But how boxing works, they Golden Boy, I think they was having me at it all along, really. They knew what they're doing. They said Manny Pacquiao is going to be stripped of the WBC light middleweight title. We can make you against Canelo for the light middleweight title, but we'll have to do it at 150 pounds. So I had a little think about it, and I said, yeah, £3, world title fight. We have to go for that. Different people saying, oh, he's struggling at welterweight, he's not even going to make that weight. But I was listening to it, and we were constantly speaking to Golden Boy, who assured us that he'd make 150 pound. Anyway, I weighs in. I was a career welterweight. I weighed in, I think it was just over 10.9. Canelo weighed in, I think he was 10.12, yeah, something
way
like
over.
That. Yeah, yeah, way over. He had 2 hours to make the weight. He come back, he was even heavier. So he clearly hadn't tried to make the weight. Again, sort of like then, I come away. People who was working then, there was my dad, Gareth Williams, the solicitor involved. They said, well, what do you want to do? I think I could have walked away with about 25% of my purse that they still would have had to pay me. They said, what do you want to do? Me being me, I'm in LA. There were a load of people went over there to support me. I'm always going to fight. But I remember saying, I'll fight, but I want compensating. So I spoke to Gareth and my dad, and they said, right, I'm going to tell them, they took the piss. I'm going to tell them we want double. So I went, right, I don't think they're going to stretch to double, but get what you can. So anyway, again, negotiation ensued and stuff like that. So I got paid double in the end.
You got paid double, right?
I got paid double, which was a nice touch. But
you
I earned every dollar, mate. I earned every dollar.
You earned the money.
And I'm glad, yeah. And I'm glad I got it now.
You don't have to tell us the figure. Well, you swerve telling me the figure anyway. But, was that the fight that sort of set you up with the lovely house you've got now and everything like that, and set you up for life financially, or had you already got to that stage before that?
No. Again, it's sort of, I did well out of boxing. A lot of fights, don't forget. 52 fights. The European title was a good title. A lot of fights over in the States. Kell Brook, another fight. I got pretty well paid for that one as well. The European title's a good earner. Had some good sponsors throughout my career. So, you know, that's what I hear a lot of boxers now. They talk about their own career and they feel that boxing has taken more than it's given to them. Mm. I worked hard, had some tough fights. I wanted to fight the best people for the best money. And I did well. Yeah, I did well out of the sport. And it was a sport that I always loved. So to get paid doing something you enjoy, you know, I've not made, you know, you got your top fighters that earning fortunes. I didn't earn that, but I did well. I did well out of the sport, yeah.
So how much did you actually make for the Canelo fight?
Oh, I can't tell you that, mate. I'll be mates. You'll be on to me for a sub.
Yeah. when you look at purses, then I knew you were. I tried people. Yeah. When you sort of you're advising Campbell, when you're advising Jack, you know your son who's coming through now, we'll talk about. Do you talk to them about the financial side of the game, or are they in that lucky position where? Because of what you did, because of what Ricky did, they don't have to worry so much about that.
Yeah, no, they've got to make their own name, haven't they? But again, I've been in professional boxing, like say 14 years there. That's just my boxing career. I've been training and managing for some times now. So generally, there's not much. I never doubt my boxing education and my boxing knowledge. I've been in around the sport. Since I was 19, I'm 42 now, seeing all these strokes that people try and play, you know, it's all from the same kind of playlist. Sometimes it's disguised in different ways, but there isn't much that I haven't seen in professional boxing. And Campbell, you know, doing well now as a professional. You know, he's got my knowledge, he's got his dad's knowledge, he's got a good team around him with Match Room, 258. He's got everything around him to make a success of himself. You know, he's just got to keep concentrating on his boxing. But yeah, it's quite lucky because he's got that network around him. He's certainly not lacking knowledge and support.
You mentioned like skullduggery in boxing and, you know, there's a lot of it. You know, we all from all different levels. Having been through a long career in boxing, would you say that it is as corrupt as people say from the outside, or it is as murky? The waters are as murky as people say from the outside.
There is some people in boxing like that. A lot of strokes being played. I honestly don't know how some people can live with themselves, some of the strokes that they play and stuff like that. In a sport like boxing where it's hard to earn your money, it's a tough, tough game, tough sport. And some of the things that do go on, you know, isn't great. I don't think it's quite as bad as some people make out. Some people think, you know, but again, different things. But yeah, I suppose it has got its bad side and... We're realists and we've got to acknowledge that. But there's also some good people in boxing as well. And I think boxing's in a good place at the minute. You know, lots of different promoters being shown in TV. They've got the streaming, of course, these days. So good time to be a boxer, I think. Good opportunities.
You mentioned Campbell. You seem to, he's obviously your nephew. They do say father and son partnerships in boxing don't always work. Was that part of the decision why... You know, Ricky wasn't going to train him, or did Ricky want to have that space removed so that, because I know he gets very nervous watching. Was that always the best fit? Do you think it just works better now it's like this?
It was just the way it panned out, how it worked out with Campbell. For Campbell and my own son, Jack, as well, I know what a tough sport boxing is, especially professional boxing. It's a hard, brutal sport. It really is. And anyone who says it isn't, he's a liar. It's a hard, brutal sport. And what happened there, so I was always reluctant to get too involved with Campbell, as I know Ricky was. We sort of like let him get on with his own thing. He was fighting as an amateur, win some, lose some. But then it got you know, again, round near where we live, he lived down the road, and I'd always see him running, and I thought, he really wants this. I was turning up, watching his fights. I've been pretty much to every single fight he's had, and he was always giving so much, but sometimes technically coming a little bit short and stuff like that. And I thought, you know what? I'm not having anybody come to me in 1-2 years' time and say, why didn't you step up to the plate and start doing it? Even though I didn't want him to do it, I could see by that stage he wanted it. He really wanted to do it. I was in a position to help him. I went and spoke to his dad first. I said, Rick, he wants it. He wants to do it. Look how he's working. He's working so hard. I want to start doing a little bit more with him. And I knew me doing that would then sort of like bring Ricky. And we started off, we was training him both together. He had certain days with Campbell and I did other days. And it worked really, really well. You know, Ricky's a busy person. If ever he wasn't there to train Campbell, I'd invariably step up. And I've always made Campbell a priority because I could see how much he wanted it. And it just the way it panned out. I started doing more and more work with him. So when it come to turning professional, it was natural for him to go with me because I'd done the bulk of the work with him, really.
He came under some fierce criticism in his early career. Still gets some now. You know, you mentioned that you yourself had some early criticism from him, so you knew the dance with that. What was that like as a family? Because I know your mum in particular watches, reads everything, you know, the comments about Campbell, etc. What was that like as a family to sort of, here we go again, and it started again, and here come the media are criticising, and here come social media?
It was tough. I mean, I was a realist. Campbell only had a limited amateur experience as well. The reason he turned professional when he did, we all sat down. It was during the thick of COVID, and there was no amateur boxing on the horizon. So sometimes you have to play with the cards you dealt. We said, Campbell could be 2 years without a fight here. So we made the decision then for him to turn professional. But I knew it was always going to take time. It wasn't going to happen overnight, and it could be tough. He did get some criticism early on, especially when he boxed on the Tottenham, on the AJ undercard at Tottenham. Again, I'm very experienced in this sport. I've been around it a long time. You know, I don't manage Campbell. I only train him. And where he was placed on the bill, I thought straight away it was wrong. But again, I'll be the first to hold my hands up. I sort of like, I went with it, even though I knew it was wrong. And after that fight, he won the fight, but he got some terrible, terrible criticism. And I thought, I'm not keeping quiet anymore. I'm going to express my opinion, even if it's not what people think or what they want to do. I'm always going to give my opinion. And again, but the criticism that he got, unbelievable. Unbelievable, some of the things. My own son, he was getting he was getting messages on Instagram and stuff like that, DM,
was he?
By different people. Yeah. Your cousin never won that fight. Blah. Unbelievable. Again, social media has got its place. I like social media. I spend a lot of time on there. But it's given the birth to some idiots. It really has. And nothing shocks you like people. And he got some terrible criticism. But whatever, you know, I suppose I'm in a good position to guide Campbell because I suffered a lot from my career, from criticism. And I think Campbell's been able to develop quite a thick skin quite early. He got some bad criticism, but he come through, he come away with a win. And I think they always say what doesn't break you makes you stronger. And I think we're starting to see that now.
Yeah. You've all got to evolve in the sport, haven't you? And you've got to come through the ups and downs, I suppose. You mentioned there that your son was getting, you know, messages in relation to that. So it does show you as well, doesn't it, that boxing nowadays, it's become kind of like, it's like a pressure cooker, really. It's intense. And there can be collateral and other people get involved, family can get involved. So I suppose that's the thing. So what keeps you on that journey?
Again, you've got to you know, you're always going to have criticism. You're always going to have haters. It comes with success, doesn't it? It comes with being in the spotlight. So there's not much you can do about it, really. Like I say, you've just got to develop a thick skin, you know, and again, and just keep yourself focused, keep applying yourself, and just try and ignore as much of it as you possibly can. It comes with the territory, doesn't it, mate? Really does.
So going on to your outlook for the future, are there any sort of things that you have in your bucket list, your dream list, you know, your vision for the future?
Do you know what? I'm really enjoying my coaching now. I've been coaching for some years, pretty successfully, actually. I only had a handful of defeats. Done well with a fighter, you know. I've had some fighters that have come, not the most experienced, not the best fighters, but I've been able to do well with them and do a good job. I'm really enjoying working with Campbell now. And I always had, even when I was boxing, it sounds strange, I was always asking people different techniques, I was always watching. I always had one eye on coaching, even when I was still boxing, something that always interests me. So, yeah, I'm enjoying the coaching now. It can be frustrating because I've been doing it some time now, and you see some kids, you know, I boxed at the top level. I was a great trainer. I was a fanatical trainer, I really was. And it's frustrating sometimes when you see, yeah, I'm going to say kids these days, they don't seem to have that drive, that determination, and that hunger, what fighters in my day had. And I've sort of like, sometimes I've got my own standards, and I've bent that a little bit to accommodate certain fighters, and I won't be doing that again. You know, if you're a good fighter, the door's open and you're willing to work. And in a professional sport and a hard sport like boxing, surely that's got to be the norm, you know. Mm. Put the effort in, apply yourself, work hard, be determined and give it everything you can. But in this day and age, mate, I can tell you it isn't, and it can be frustrating. So, yeah, I've got my gym now. I enjoy my coaching. I'm a boxing fan. I always have been. And as you get older, mate, there's less and less things excite you, isn't there? But the fight nights, I still look forward to it. And again, I've got my gym going now, all geared around the boxing, which is busy. Obviously, I've got my manager's license. There's some fighters that I train as well. Do other things now. I do a bit of work with Stockport Council for kids getting into noughties. I've done that for a few years on a Friday evening, but all geared around the boxing. So I'm fortunate, and again, I touched on it early on. All I hear these days is fighters going on and on and about what the sport's taken from them. And boxing's done this, boxing's done that. Boxing's been great to me. I've always been a boxing fan. I enjoyed every single second of my fighting career. My own regret, I always wanted to be a world champion. It never quite happened. Could it have happened? I think so. I think that the night I fought Canelo, I was really well-ranked at the time in all the welterweight governing bodies. If I'd have been a little bit more smarter, a little bit more patient, made the right moves at the right time, people like Held, that Senchenko, who Ricky fought late, do I think I could have beaten him? Yeah. But do I regret it? No. Boxing's been great to me. And I'm still involved now, enjoying the coaching. Maybe I'll get to train a world champion one day. You've always got to set yourself goals. And again, I take my boxing very seriously. I always have done. I'm always in 100%. I'm committed to what I do. So again, have high aspirations. You know, I like I touched on with my own kids, try and be the best. You know, little Jack upstairs, he only had 18 fights. But if someone asked Jack what did he want to do, I'd expect him to say world champion.
Yeah.
Great, you know, like say, sports always been a big part for me. But if you're going to do it, play to win, be the best you can be. And I look back on my own career and I'm proud of what I achieved. especially when people were writing me out early on. Could have been a world champion, didn't quite pan out, but I got the best out of myself. And as a coach, that's what I try and get out of fighters now, but it can be frustrating.
Do you think that boxing, retired fighters, do you think the boxing in a way should help them after retirement? You do hear a lot of, and there's some great arguments for it, especially when you see some of the states, some of the fighters get into. Also with other industries, they don't, you know, when you leave, like I left teaching after 13 years, and the teaching industry doesn't do anything for me now. But boxing obviously is a different sport. Do you think there's a requirement for some sort of aftercare for boxing? Obviously it's a physical and brutal sport.
It is a brutal sport. Maybe there should be something in place for fighters to stay involved. I think a good thing would be maybe the board could do something, and whether they've started doing it, I'm not too sure actually about how to look after your money and how to invest your money properly and do stuff like that. Again, we live in that society now, don't we, where it's the blame game. Everyone's to blame. It's his fault. He's done this, he's done that. Some of these people don't help themselves, do they? So it sounds possibly a bit harsh, that. But I do think something should be in place to help fighters when they finish boxing. But that's the culture we live in now, the blame game. It's always someone else's fault and stuff like that. Sometimes you've just got to help yourself as well, haven't you?
And to finish on an upbeat note, your son, Jack, it feels like it's gone quite quick, because one minute he's not a boxer and then the next minute he's in the amateur ranks, and then the next minute I'm speaking to him and he's shot up and he's talking like a boxer, talking all things boxing. So you didn't have any reservations? You always thought, you know what, I'm going to support Jack if he wants to be a boxer?
Yeah, I didn't want him to box. I didn't want Campbell to box. But we were talking before about genetics and stuff like that. We've seen it time and time again, even more so recently, the Conor Benn, Chris Eubank, they seem to Hamed's son the other day. Yep. So it seems to be happening more and more, and it's a hard, tough sport, but you are who you are. And Campbell wanted to box, now Jack wants to box, and they want to do it. So both myself and Ricky, you know, got a lot of experience, a lot of knowledge. So if they want to do it, you know, even if you don't like it and you can help them and get on board with it, we're going to help them both as much as we possibly can. And, you know, I'm sort of like to think I've always been pretty sensible. I've got my family now. I know that I've seen boxing from inside the ropes. I've seen boxing from outside the ropes. I know what a tough sport it is, the risks involved in boxing. Would I go and do it all over again? I wish I could, because it's who I am. It's what I am. And it seems that it's who Jack is and who Campbell is. And boxing's been very good to me, been very good to Campbell's dad, Ricky. He's done exceptionally well out of the sport. So why can't they do it?
I did an interview with your mum about, it must be nearly a decade, I suppose. It was a long, long time. I can't even remember, actually. A long, long time ago. And she said, me two lads didn't do bad off the estate. I think I titled it something like that. Me two lads didn't do bad, did they? And it's a fitting sentiment, isn't it, really? It's true.
It is. And that's the great thing that I like about boxing. It's in your own hands. Some people have a different path, an easier path than others. But, you know, when shit gets real, it's in your own hands. And tough sport, you know, and I loved every moment of it. I really did. Fortunate to still be involved now with the coaching. And still a boxing fan. Always have been and always will be.
Well, the last thing that I'll say is give us a quick prediction on a couple of fights. Quick prediction of some fights coming up.
You love these Ask Matt, don't you?
Ask Matt, yeah. We can't.
I must have won you a few quid over the years, you know.
Yeah, you've lost me a few as well on some of your predictions. I'll do a quick fire one.
Well,
you
didn't back me to beat Canelo, did you?
I did, yeah. Well, I backed the rematch. I'm surprised a rematch never happened.
Oh, especially the state it made of his hands.
AJ White, who wins?
AJ knockout.
Dubois Usyk, who wins?
Usyk knockout.
Fury Ngannou.
Fury knockout.
Fury Usyk.
Ooh, that's a good one. I would back Fury, just both great fighters, purely because of the size. Big size difference there, and a could that could swing it his way. Not with much confidence though. I think quite clear now that they're the two best fighters. And let's see him in the ring. Like you said, we were talking before, shooting himself up in the foot boxing, it really is. Let's get these big fights made. And what a great start that one would be. But yeah, I'd go for Fury.
Amen to that. Let's get these fights made. Well, Matt, it's been a pleasure speaking to you. I've enjoyed looking back at, your career, but also your upbringing, finding out a bit more about you and your family life and everything. And is there anything you want to say on a final note to anyone watching?
No, I think we've covered a lot there, mate. And again, it's sort of, I've enjoyed it, looking back on my career, fond memories, and a great sport. And I've enjoyed it.
Top man. Well, onwards and upwards, and see you for our next At Matt in a few weeks.
Always, mate, always.
Cheers, mate.
No problem.
Winter, it was bitterly cold. We had to wee in a bucket. And my dad was a hard, hard man, which everybody was. Every man was. Don't forget, they'd all been to the war. Fill up now, you know what I mean? And I was a great electrician in the respect of, how are we going to get up there? I'll get up there. And he gave us some money, Dennis Law. And it was like, wow. And we went and got something to eat. I worked in Guyana. I built a bridge across the Demerara River. Congressman Ryan got shot dead and they made a big poison and 900 plus people committed suicide. And I looked down and in one of the gutters, there was a dead body. And Sam went right, Frankie went left, and they were shooting live ammunition. But I did a little bit too much of that. And then I ended up getting a name that don't mess with Kerry. A week later, they'd found Mike Tyson. And Chris, I can talk now, Chris put a gun to his head. Police estimated he was doing 80 mile an hour. I was doing 30 mile an hour. And he hit me head on. And I'm emotional now. I put my arms around him and said, they've had to cut your leg off, mate. They've had to cut your leg off. I started going to Vegas with Ricky and having a right good laugh and enjoying myself 24/7, the Mayweather and all that. I started playing. We weren't made to feel welcome. We were not made to feel welcome, that's the best way I can say it. And I thought, Kerry, that was pretty good. I'm satisfied. Could satisfaction and happiness be the same thing?
Blessed Lord must have had an answer for me for something else, because I shouldn't be here. I found my own way from zero. I've got about 12 to 15 bags of horse shit in the back of this van, and it's like that. There was violence, plenty of money, and you had to deal with things properly. I've had 4 or 5 assassination attacks. I'm going to do. Your father said you're either going to end up dead or doing a lifetime in prison. I've had guns go off at close range. I've had all kinds of things. They had me down as running and controlling an army. Put me near a sex offender. I said, I'll kill him straight out. You play ball with us. Keep the peace in the prison. We'll have an easy life and you have an easy life. So I says, yeah. I said, give that money back because I'll break your arms and legs. He says, you're a fighter, aren't you? I said, do you fucking right, Adam, yeah. He said, well, fight back then. It wasn't for my wife and kids. I said, I'd get a bullet. I said, I'll put it right between your 2 eyes. But I've been betrayed many times. I don't leave my people behind. I take them with me. He's dying. When I say dying, he's about to have his head blown off. He's one very lucky man that I drove past there. Good comes over evil 7 days a week. I've got unfinished business in boxing, so I'm going to keep going.
My dad in the travelling community
was a force to be reckoned with. Dad was a one-man army. Tyson, from going to the gym, within a month, he was the king of the gym. But they had bats and everything, and he was beating me up. And everyone was holding the doors. And then and Tyson looked around, like, where's Shane? Because my dad was in jail. Tyson was overweight. Tyson was going to go to Brendan Ingalls. What a lot of people don't know, yeah, Tyson used to suffer with nerves, yeah? Underperformed when it mattered. So Tyson learned to deal with it at the right time. And he was also told, being a straight-up boxer don't sell, so you have to be what he is today. Okay, so we went to a doctor. The doctor certified him crazy. Straight jacket job. He did go down, very down. Tyson's a bad champion. It rubbed him cold. And he said, it was the worst feeling of my life. Never felt nothing like it. And I never want to feel it again.
I found another way of life, yeah. And I loved the streets, and the streets loved me. And as I'm smiling in my head, I'm thinking, what a fucking prick. I don't like bullies. So I mean, if I'm going to do anything, it's someone on a level. We're on the same level. We're living the same kind of life. It's a jungle. We're in the jungle. We're all animals, and it's kill or be killed. It's do or die. Got caught with in a hotel with a loaded firearm, and then went to jail. It was horrible jail. Didn't get no shower, and I ended up banging a screw. And I set up a security firm, and we was doing the doors around Oldham, Hyde, Denton, Middleton. Yeah, I had a security firm. Everything that I've ever done in my life, because I need to do shit again. You know what hurt me more than anything? When Brian passed away. Yeah. This is what hurt me the most. While Collier's the Mostyn is alive, Brian Hughes is alive. While I'm having to do with that gym, he's alive.